But not least, I would like to present my dear friend, Professor Omar Zakaria from NCI Egypt. Dr. Omar will be talking to us about breast reconstruction with biblical autologous tissues, tips and tricks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I know that most of you are very tired and very hungry. I'll try to make it very short. I have this feeling that I came to the wrong room because the previous speakers were speaking about implants, and I'm going to speak about a totally different subject, about the autologous breast reconstruction. If we have a look here, we will see all types of reconstruction, starting from very simple procedures like the implants and ending by very complex procedures like the free flaps. Although, as a surgeon, and all of you know very, very well that there are no such simple procedures in surgery. Before going into details, I just would like to remind you with this very famous article that was published in Cancer in 2009 about the SEER follow-up of more than 50,000 patients in the UK that proved that immediate post-mastectomy reconstruction is associated with improved breast cancer-specific survival. So now it's very well known and very safe to do the immediate reconstruction. What's the rationale of the autologous tissue? Well, it's an alive and natural tissue. It changes and modifies with age. It's the ideal replacement because you are replacing tissue by the same tissue, and it could cover large quantity of tissue defects. However, it's a more longer procedures. It needs a very specific post-operative care, prolonged recovery time, and when complications occur, it might affect the delivery of the adjuvant treatment, and of course, the radiotherapy sequelae after such type of reconstructions. There are no clear indications for autologous tissue. Becomes the first one to be very well known is the patient preference. We still have some problems with the implants from a cultural point of view in our region. When we need ample tissue, and when the patient has an ample tissue at the desired donor site, whether it is in the abdomen, the thorax, or in the gluteal region, it's indicated for those patients with a BMR more than 30, when there is a history of previous radiation to the breast, and if there are multiple scars on the breast. If we look at the UK audit that was published in 2011, we will find that the pedicle flaps represented both equal as both the implant expanders and free flaps. And if we go into more details regarding the timing of reconstruction, we find that the pedicle flaps, whether with the implant or without, are always the same incidence, whether it is an immediate or delayed reconstruction. As you see in this diagram, there are a lot of places that you can use for reconstruction, but for the pedicled flaps, we will only speak about these two techniques, whether the LD flap or the tram flap. To start with the LD flap, I just would like to remind you that it was first described in 1896, more than 100 years ago, and this means it's a very successful technique being in the history for all this period. What's the function of the LD flap? It adapts, extends, and medially rotates the shoulder. But you have to know that there are six other muscles doing the same job for the shoulder. For the anatomy, it's a very wide flap, so it can cover a wide area, and it can cover easily any implant. Its blood supply is derived from the thoracodorsal artery, and the three most important structures are the pedicle itself, the nerve, and the tendon. The advantages are so many. Mainly, it's a very versatile flap, easy, reliable, and does not require any special instrumentation. In these pictures, you can see the different diagrams with different designs for the LD flap, depending on what you want to do. Whether it is an expanded LD flap, so you get a bigger skin island, and if it's just a skin muscle to cover an implant, so you just need a very small skin island, and sometimes you only need the muscle to cover a defect. Each type of reconstruction has its own precautions. Whether you are going to do an immediate breast reconstruction, you have to know what's the type of aspect you are going to use, the defect that it will be left over, the neurovascular pedicle, the contralateral breast shape and size. While for the delayed breast reconstruction, the scarring is very important, the type of the chest wall and the integrity of the neurovascular bundle, especially when the patient is irradiated. While when you are using the LD flap for just a volume replacement, it's just to calculate the volume to be resected and to replace it with the equal volume of the LD. And these are different examples. So the first one you can see, it's you will find the you will find the an extended LD, the second one an LD with an implant, then volume replacement and skin reducing mastectomies. Each one has its own different technique. There are no absolute contraindications for the LD flap except for those patients who have a major concern regarding their shoulder joint. And in brief, these only are for those professional players who need every single arc of movement in their shoulder movement. A lot of publications regarding the safety of this technique. The most recent one was published a few months ago, the BRS, about a systematic review that concluded that there is, after 1 year, the shoulder joint regained complete full power and function after LD flap. This is an example of when you can use the autologous or when you can use the pedicle LD flap. This is a typical case with the bilateral mastectomies with postoperative radiotherapy, and you can see a lot of scars over the chest wall and very tight skin. This is an absolute contraindication for an implant, and you have to find a good alternative to reconstruct both breasts. And the answer would be an extended LD, bilateral extended LD. And this is the postoperative picture after 1 month. There are so many details that you should take care of, like the position of the patient. For example, you have to put the patient in the lateral decubitus with shoulder and elbow in upright 90 degrees in order to avoid a nerve injury and for patient safety. And you have to plan where you are going to put your scar, and this is the ideal scar where it should be put under the bra line, so it is covered most of the time. One of the major morbidities that we face in LD flap is the seroma. It's reported to be more than 80% in most of the literature, but after the quilting, and this is a study that proved that the quilting of the chest wall decreases very much the seroma, and in our experience, it decreases the seroma from 80% to less than 13%. However, still seroma is part of the LD flap. Whether to use the extended LD or the LD with an implant, this is an issue to be discussed. It all depends on what you want to do, what's your goal, whether you need an added tissue which gives you better result, and whether you want to avoid the use of implant in order to avoid any further interventions or change of implants. LD flap still has its own complications, and this is one of the rare cases when some of the angiosomes of the LD flap was affected. So when we brought back the patient to the OR, you can find that the muscle itself is bloody and it's full of blood. However, the skin is very much affected. And this is one of the rare cases when you've got different blood supply for the LD flap. Now we shift quickly to the transverse rectus abdominis myocutaneous flap. It's a more lengthy procedure. We are going to speak about the pedicle flap flap, which is either a monopedicle or a bipedicle, whether it is in an ipsilateral or contralateral. And we, in the history we used to do the autonomization or delayed tram flap with a supercharged or turbo microvascular anastomosis in the axilla. If you just type tram flap and breast reconstruction on PubMed, you will find more than 1,000 articles speaking about tram flap, because it is very well known and it is the gold standard in breast reconstruction. Regarding the history of Trent Lab, it all started in 79 and it was described as a free flap first, a free abdominoplasty flap, and it was described by Armstrong in Sweden. Then the very famous Hartram described the pitiful Trent Lab in 1982. The advantages of the Trent Lab are so many because it's a very good coverage, it gives you a very a big area to cover, so it's very well indicated in skin deficit. You a very natural look because it contains fat that resembles very much the fat of the breast. It is very much superior over breast implants and it can withstand the radiotherapy whether pre-reconstruction or after reconstruction. In 60% of cases you do not need to touch the contralateral breast. It's indicated when you have a previously failed operation, either an implant or any type of flap. And it is indicated for those with excess lower abdominal tissue and patient desires both abdominoplasty or refuse a contralateral surgery. These are now an absolute contraindications for using the Trent Lab, especially for those patients with comorbidities like cardiac or pulmonary disease, diabetes, smoking, older patients. Previous abdominal surgery is not anymore a contraindication, as we'll see later on, and in some patients with collagen vascular disease. You all know very well the anatomy of the Trent Lab. It has dual blood supply, either from the superior epigastric or the inferior epigastric, but we all know very well that the inferior epigastric is the main dominant blood supply to the Trent Lab, and this is a superior point for the free Trent compared to the pedicle Trent Lab. This is just a drawing to show you the area, the zones of the pedicle Trent Lab. It is divided into four zones. One and two are medial and lateral to the pedicle, and three and four are very lateral to the pedicle on both sides, that you have to discard them during your operation. Why Trent Lab? This is the answer. The only way to cover such a defect would be a Trent Lab. This is a patient with bilateral breast cancer with radionecrotic ulcers. She underwent bilateral mastectomy, and we were left over with this defect, and the only option is to cover it with a bipedicle Trent Lab. Whether immediate or delayed, there is no problem, you can do it both times, but as previously discussed, it's much better to do it on immediate basis for the psychological reasons. We try to minimize the surgical intervention, so immediate would be better. Actual treatment for cancer must be considered, and any failure rate is higher in the immediate Trent Lab. The drawbacks of immediate reconstruction is the increased length of operation, the difficult logistics, because it takes longer time in the OR, it's a more complex surgery and more complex post-operative care. Again, this is a systematic review about the effect of immediate reconstruction on the delivery of adjuvant treatment, and it concluded that the current literature showed that immediate breast reconstruction does not necessarily delay the start of adjuvant chemotherapy to a clinically relevant extent, suggesting that in general, immediate breast reconstruction is a valid option for non-metastatic breast cancer patients. In brief, none is have a contraindication for immediate breast reconstruction, but proper counseling and proper MDT to know whether the patient would need an adjuvant treatment is a must. Again, whether to use a pedicle Trent Lab or a free flap, there are no differences. Both avoid the prosthetic complications, both give the natural shape and natural ptosis, both decrease the need for a contralateral surgery, both are available and they give better or stable results. But for the free flap, it's technically more difficult. It needs more trained surgeons for microsurgery with an increased rate of blood loss. Instead of flap, partial necrosis is more in the pedicle Trent Lab. Operative time in our experience is about 4 hours. Professor Rezai mentioned 2 hours. Well, my record was 3 hours, 20 minutes. So I will never beat you, so we have to think about the abdominal scarring and its complications. The pedicle Trent Lab gives us a very long pedicle, which helps us in modification and remodeling of the flap, while in the TR flap or the free flap, we have a short pedicle and we are a little bit afraid to do this modeling because of the microvascular anastomosis. And these are some examples. You can never differ between a free flap or a pedicle tramp flap after 6 months. Both have the very good cosmetic results. We were the first to compare between the immediate free or pedicle tramp flap in 2005, and we found out that there is no difference between both techniques. The aesthetic outcome was similar, same flap tissue, same shaping. Good results are possible using both techniques, but statistical analysis is required for aesthetic results evaluation. In brief, if you are going to do a pedicle tramp flap, these are the indications. It depends on your patient's needs. Abdominal perforations are available or no. Young and active patients is towards a free tramp flap. Medium to general condition, advanced tumors, and obese patients are required for a pedicle tramp flap. These are very meticulous operative details regarding the anesthesia, DVT, prophylaxis, surgical techniques, and challenging. And this is a very short clip just to show you our technique doing the pedicle tramp flap. And as you can see, this patient is calling for a tramp. You can see her belly with a redundant skin. So this is a very good indication for a tramp, pedicle tramp flap. First step is the creation of the tunnel, as you can see, until the chest wall. Then we dissect all the perforators from both sides. Then we ligate the deep inferior epigastric, and then we start to check our vascularity. We discard the zone 4 completely, and we make sure that it bleeds very well. If not, you have to cut more. So you get rid completely of the zone 4. And you can see that it is bleeding. So you are cutting in the right level. Then you can discard more than 50% of zone 3. So it remains with you the zone 1, 2, and part of zone 3. And again, you have to check the vascularity very well, and you check that it is bleeding very well. So you can know that you are cutting in the right and your zone of the area. And as you can see, it's bleeding from the edges. And this is very satisfying. This is the most important step. We cut back the inferior epigastric pedicle to make sure that there is a backflow, very nice chalk anastomotic vessels between the superior and inferior epigastric vessels. And you can see both colors of blood are coming, dark blood venous and bright blood for the arteriate. And then in order to secure the flap, in order to avoid the shearing movement, we ligate, we fix the muscle to the flap itself. Then this is the most important step, the delivery of the flap into the chest wall. And then you have to verify very well that the pedicle is not twisted and it's not under tension. And you have to make sure that the flap is lying easily on the chest wall. Then you completely forget about the flap now and you start to close the abdomen because it is very technical. Since 2005, we stopped completely using any meshes. We closed the tramp flap primarily with no meshes at all. This is the immediate post-operative, this is 3 weeks post-operatively. We try to put the inferior scar at the inframammary sinus. Again, just to remind you that we do not use meshes at all. We do not do any bipedicle tramp flaps, it's only monopedicle, and we close the fascia primarily. And I will show you our instance in the hernia. These are some of the post-operative complications. The commonest causes are the necrosis. Partial necrosis depending on the zone that you are leaving it. But as you may see, we always put the least vascularized area into the axilla in order if you excise it, you don't affect the cosmetic appearance of the whole flap. This is one of the cases that developed hernia. You can see it's a huge hernia, and this was for medical reason. This is another case who underwent an immediate reconstruction with the tramp flap, and I just want to show you the effect of radiotherapy and skin desquamation on the flap. However, the flap itself is very healthy. And it does not cover the, any kind of local recurrence. It's very easily detectable, the local recurrence, with either clinical or with any radiological imaging. But you have to put into consideration that the tramp lab is a very tedious procedure and it's a very long one. We always start by the reconstruction of the breast. And as you can see, with the delayed reconstruction, you can still have very good inframammary sulcus. And then you work on the contralateral procedure by an inferior pedicle reduction mammoplasty. And this is postoperative. And this is how the patient looks at the end with symmetrical good shape of both breasts. Another issue that we have to mention always is the dynamic biological process. The body of the lady keeps on growing, increases in fat, she gains more weight, so the breast becomes bigger, but the flap does not get bigger like the normal tissue. And after 5 years, you will find this discrepancy in volume. And this patient, she asked for an augmentation on the affected side and mastopexy on this side. So everything is doable with a tramp lab. This is another case who did delayed reconstruction with a tramp lab in 2008. A few months ago, she developed contralateral breast cancer. You can see the biological behavior of the tramp lab on the left side, and she underwent skin sparing mastectomy and the reconstruction with an LD, extended LD flap. These are some of the literature regarding the abdominal complications, and they all are speaking about the necrosis and hernia, which is in the range of 12%. In our experience, as I told you, we do not do any bipedicle, we do not use any meshes, and the incidence of flap necrosis, partial flap necrosis, was about 12%, where 14 patients of them necessitated to have re-surgery again. Regarding the hernia, we only had 2 cases from 124 patients with a percentage of 1.6, which is acceptable. In conclusion, before going into more details, I just would like to remind you that when you are counseling your patient, there are so many things you are discussing regarding the type of reconstruction, whether immediate or delayed, whether you are going to use a tramp flap, an LD flap, pedicle or free flap. But you have to put into consideration that first you are dealing with a cancer patient. You have to deal first with the cancer and then you think about the type of reconstruction. And you have to know that the proper case selection will save you from so many complications. Preoperative planning is a must. Intraoperative procedures, you have to be very meticulous with every step you are doing, and your final outcome is your goal. In conclusion, as I said, patient selection is the most important step. Key performance indicators should be always put into consideration, and all tools should be readily available. And you should follow what you know, not what literature others know. Patient safety is above all concerns. I started my talk with the word simple, and I will finish with the word simple. Everything should be made as simple as possible, but not simple. Thank you very much.
Such a wonderful presentation, and now the floor is open for any questions. Yes, sir.
Professor Pombe?
Yep, Homer. I would like to know your impression with the partial necrosis when you need a bigger flap with the medical one. Because in that condition, we have chosen in the last 2 years the middle range solution. We are doing a turbocharged kind unipedicle and the internal mammary vessel anastomosis. In this way, we are almost eliminating the possibility to have partial necrosis as a good compromise, even because, as you said, even with the muscle-sparing free flap, we had anyway some partial necrosis. Michaela says, Jean-Louis Maziat, the other friends of microsurgical, they told us that sometimes if you don't have a specific technology like SPI technology or more sophisticated kind of radiology, it's almost impossible to have a Z region of the vascular.
I agree with you, and we have to know that it is a very challenging surgery. You finish, you do a very nice flap, and at the end of the day, you find some minor necrosis. So you can never predict what the turbocharged flap we used to do, it's a very good alternative when you need a bigger or larger volume of flaps. I totally agree with you.
Thank you very much for the nice.
use a delay?
No.
No. So that means we use it in our university patients and like this. So, and I'm so happy with this procedure. So especially when you do it from 2 days before the surgery, you have the biggest benefit from the delay. And even by very risky patients and obese patients especially, so it's possible to extend the delay. And so wait a few days to see how many clamps you can remain. And one point which I saw the zone 1, 2, 3, 4, which you showed, I think that's about the zone deflation from her heart valve. And this is definitely changed now
for
many years. Because the zone 1 and 2 are the same in the one part of the flaps. And the zone 3 and 4 is the other part.
The other part.
Yeah.
There are some controversies regarding these zones. But when you speak with the anatomists, they believe that the perforatus medially and you have two lines of perforatus, medial and lateral, on the pedicle. So they believe that the medial follow zone 1 and the lateral would go for zone 2. That's why they want to put the zone 3 and 4 on the contralateral side. We, as surgeons, or how we were trained that zone 4, the most distal part, this is the one that you should get rid of, and zone 3, whether it is medial to it or on the other side, as long as you've got very healthy and bleeding, well, it suits us. But regarding the other issue, that the delay, it's very nice, but again, for some non-medical reasons, it's very hard to convince a patient to go to the OR twice in less than 48 hours. Sometimes we used to do it before the start of adjuvant treatment, during the mastectomy itself, but this means that you know from the start that the patient is going to do the reconstruction with the transplant. So it's a mainly logistic problem rather than medical. But
that's quite a risk patient, obvious patient, radiated patient is quite a good option.
You do it before the surgery, 48 hours before surgery?
Usually, or it's the best time. But when you do perform mastectomy, or might be the reduction of plastic before,
Yes.
So I combine two together, so they don't go back to the surgery.
As you saw, we don't do ever the symmetrization at the same time the transplant. We always wait, because first of all, it's too much for the patient. It will take longer time, and we like to wait until the flap settles down and we see how it looks, and then we start to manage the contralateral procedure.
I don't do also not the same time the symmetrization, but I do the same thing. It's first, but it's by the delay to reconstruction.
With the delay, yeah.
Yes, I do the delay with the reduction of the plastic. So I have an orientation how I can shape my flap. I can adjust it to the very nice breast, you know. But when you perform your flap in a very pathetic breast, it is quite not easy on the table to have orientation.
Yeah, it's a good idea.
So I change the sequence, and now the distinctive result is quite much better.
It's a good idea. Thank you.
So, I might ask you, when you do the vascular delay, sir, do you do the vascular delay or just incisions for the proposed
vascular delay? Only vascular. And also the superficial.
Yeah,
vascular delay.
Thank you, and this is the closing of our session, and looking forward to seeing you tomorrow. Thank you very much.